Welcome to worship with the Lutheran Church of our Savior. Welcome to our guests, our friends, our family, our members, everybody who is here gathered together as the church, and we are the church. Our church council has not yet set a date for us to return to be physically together again for worship. There's a lot to consider. Life is precious. We are called to love our neighbor. And so we don't know when we're yet going to be back together, but we are thinking about and figuring out how we can still be church, because we are church. So all of us together now, who are gathered here on the sixth week of Easter, we are the church worshiping and praying and celebrating the risen Lord Jesus Christ. Our worship folder, you might want to print that ahead of time, so that you can follow along with the worship service, but most everything that we have is going to be on the screen anyway, so even if you don't have the worship folder in front of you, you'll be able to worship. Christ is risen! Alleluia! Let us now together join in singing the gathering song. It's on page 2 in your worship folder. It's Come Thou Almighty King. Let us sing. grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Let us pray. Almighty and ever-living God, you hold together all things in heaven and on earth. In your great mercy, receive the prayers of all your children, and give to all the world the spirit of your truth and peace. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. It's now time for the children's message. So all the kids, I invite you to come together. Come on. If you're not already here, come and join us. Good morning, friends. I'm so glad to see you again. How are you? Are you getting bored? Are you wishing you were back at school? Yes? No. Yes? So where are you right now? Are you in your living room? Are you in your kitchen? Are you in your bedroom? Or where are you right now? And who's with you? Are you by yourself? Or are you with someone else? Because here's what I want you to do. I want you to right now sit next to someone else who's in the house with you. So it could be your mom or your dad or your brother or your sister or your grandpa, your grandma. It could even be a dog or a cat. But I think a person would be better. So go get someone right now if they're not already there and sit next to them. I'm going to get someone too. Hello, dear, sweetie, are you here?
Hello.
Will you come, please? I'm with the friends. We're doing the children's time, the kids' time.
Hi, friends.
All right, so what I want you to do is to sit close to the person next to you. Now I want you to sit even closer. Get really close to the person next to you. How close can you get? And now get even closer. How close can you get? Oh, we're trying. This is, I think, as close as we can get. How close can you get? Okay, so now, do you know that Jesus is even closer than this? Jesus was so worried about his friends, the disciples we call them sometimes, that after he left, that they would be lonely, that they would be sad and scared, and they would feel very alone. And so, Jesus said, "You are in me, and I'm in you. Even after I go, we are so close together. How close can you get?" That's how close. No, Jesus is even closer than that. So, you know, some people are not as lucky as you and me that they're living in their house all by themselves right now. But this is something for you and for them and for all of us, is to remember Jesus when he said, "I am in you and you are in me." That's how close. You are never alone. Don't ever be lonely, because as close as you can get, get close again. Are you really close? Jesus is even closer. Okay, let's pray. Let's put our hands together and repeat after me. Everybody, please. Thank you, God.
Thank you, God.
For sending us Jesus.
For sending us Jesus.
To show us.
To show us.
How much you love us.
How much you love us.
And how you will never.
And how you will never.
Ever.
Ever.
Leave us alone.
Leave us alone.
Amen.
Amen.
Thanks for coming. See you next time.
Show us how to serve the neighbors we have from you. first reading is from the seventh chapter of Acts. Paul stood in front of the Areopagus and said, "Athenians, I see how extremely religious you are in every way, for I went through the city and looked carefully at the objects of your worship. I found among them an altar with the inscription, 'To an unknown God.' What therefore you worship as unknown, this I proclaim to you. The God you made the world and everything in it, the one who is Lord of heaven and earth, does not live in shrines made by human hands. Nor is God served by human hands as though needing anything, since that very God gives to all the mortals life and breathes in all things. From one ancestor, God made all nations to inhabit the whole earth, and he allotted the time of their existence and the boundaries of the places where they should live, so that they would search for God and perhaps grope for and find God. Though indeed God is not far from each one of us. For in God we live and move and have our being, as even some of our own poets have said, 'For we too are the offspring of God.' Since we are God's offspring, we ought not to think that the deity is like gold or silver or stone, an image formed by the art and imagination of mortals. While God has overlooked the times of human ignorance, now God commands all people everywhere to repent, because God has fixed a day on which to judge the world in righteousness by a man whom God has appointed. And of this, God has given assurance to all by raising him from the dead." The second reading is from the second chapter of 1 Peter. "Who will harm you if you are eager to do what is good? But even if you do suffer for doing what is right, you are blessed. Do not fear what they fear, and do not be intimidated, but in your hearts sanctify Christ as Lord. Always be ready to make your defense to anyone who demands from you an accounting for the hope that is in you, yet do it with gentleness and reverence. Keep your conscience clear, so that when you are maligned, those who abuse you for your good conduct in Christ may be put to shame. For it is better to suffer for doing good, if suffering should be God's will, than to suffer is for doing evil. For Christ also suffered for sins once for all, the righteous for the unrighteous, in order to bring you to God. He was put to death in flesh, but made alive in the spirit, in which also he went and made a proclamation to spirits in prison, who in former times did not obey, when God waited patiently in the days of Noah. During the building of the ark, in which a few, that is, eight persons were saved through water, and baptism, which this prefigured now saves you, not as removal of dirt from the body, but an appeal to God for a good conscience, through the resurrection of Jesus Christ, who has gone into heaven and is at the right hand of God, with angels, authorities, and powers made subject to him."
Holy Gospel according to John, the 14th chapter. Jesus said, "If you love me, you will keep my commandments. And I will ask the Father, who will give you another advocate to be with you forever. This is the Spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive, whom the world neither sees nor knows. You know the Spirit, because the Spirit abides with you and will be in you. I will not leave you orphaned. I am coming to you. In a little while, the world will no longer see me, but you will see me. Because I live, you also will live. On that day, you will know that I am in my Father, and you in me, and I in you. They who have my commandments and keep them are those who love me. And those who love me will be loved by my Father, and I will love them and reveal myself to them. The Gospel of the Lord. I can't wait until things are back to normal. It's gonna be so good. It's gonna feel so good when we get back to our normal routines, normal lives. I mean, our lives, our world has changed so much, and it's gonna feel so good to get back to before all this change. Back to the time when things were normal. It's gonna be comforting. It's going to be a relief, but also time of joy. Back to normal. That's what we all want, right? Oh, wait a second. This just occurred to me. Did you think I was talking about myself? That those were my words? No, what I was doing was I was trying to imagine the disciples, Jesus' disciples, after he was gone, after he had left them. How would they have been feeling? Especially when Jesus returned to them as the resurrected Jesus, as the resurrected Christ, that he was back living with them and among them. And I can just see them saying, well, okay, now Jesus, you're back. Now we can get back to normal. We're back together again. We can get back to the normal routines. I mean, there were a lot of really weird days that we had together. But most of the days we were just together. And you were teaching us, you were talking to us, you were showing us. And you were loving us and taking care of us, and you were teaching us. And you were there. We ate together, we slept together, we lived together, we traveled together. Just get back to normal when we could be together, and we could touch, we could hug each other. We were living in close quarters. Sometimes we got on each other's nerves. Because Jesus, you snored some. Well, okay. Jesus never snored. But you can hear the disciples thinking that. Jesus is back. Now we can get back to normal. Because that was so good. However, they never got back to that normal. That normal that they knew before never returned. Instead, they had to get used to something else, to a new normal, you might say. And so, here's Jesus. This is in what in the Gospel of John is called, sometimes called the farewell discourse. Jesus is concerned for his disciples, and so he's sharing with them, telling them, and he says, I will ask the Father to give you another advocate, another one. Now the word there, advocate, I know you love it when I give you some of that ancient Greek, that biblical Greek. So the word is actually parakletos. Parakletos. I will ask the Father to give you another parakletos. And parakletos has been variously translated over the years as helper, counselor, encourager, comforter. Not that kind of comforter. Thanks, dear, for your help. But most literally, parakletos is translated as advocate. And what Jesus is talking about is the Spirit. The Spirit will come and be those things for you. Helper, counselor, encourager, comforter, advocate. And boy, if we don't need a helper, counselor, encourager, comforter, advocate now, I don't know when we would need it. Because we're not going to get back to normal. So the new normal, that's a term that we've been using for a long time. This is going to be the new normal, and we have to get used to the new normal. But I've been hearing a phrase these days saying that we're not now living in a new normal. We're living in a new abnormal. Have you heard that? A new abnormal. See, normal is something that if you look it up in a dictionary, normal is something that is routine. It's comfortable. It's natural. It comes to feel natural. But abnormal is something that is off. It's something that's not comfortable. Abnormal is something that you don't really want. Abnormal. We're living now in a new abnormal. Because in so many ways, our lives are not going to get back to what it was before, including church. We're not going to be as we were exactly before. It's going to be different. It's going to be different in a lot of ways. And our whole lives are going to be like that. And so, that's why, these readings are assigned. It's a every 3-year cycle. And we've had this series of readings, these gospel readings especially, where Jesus is talking about good shepherd, being a shepherd, having a home, preparing a place for us, and now being a helper, counselor, encourager, comforter, advocate. I think this is the Spirit working. To give us this promise that Jesus makes that we will not be alone. And even as we live in the abnormal, the disciples never got back to that. They had to live in a totally different kind of world. They didn't have their life with Jesus as it was before. They had to live in a different kind of world, and things were shifting and changing all the time. And they had to adjust and adapt. But in all of that, they were not alone, and they felt that because Jesus had promised it, and now they lived it. And so now, we who are living in the new abnormal, let us receive this promise of the one that Jesus promises, that the Father will send, the Spirit. So which Spirit do you need right now? Which Spirit how is the Spirit speaking to you? How can the Spirit be present for you? Which Spirit do you need right now? Do you need the Helper? Do you need the Comforter? Do you need the Counselor? Do you need the Encourager? Do you need the Advocate? How can this Spirit be present for you in this new abnormal? Which Spirit do you need right now? Christ is risen. Alleluia. Christ is risen. Alleluia. Let us now sing the hymn of the day. It's on the worship folder, in the worship folder on page 6. You are mine. Thank you.
join me as we together confess our faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived of the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sin, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. As we welcome God into the sanctuaries of our homes, let us pray for all the needs of the world. Creating God, revitalize the health of oceans, rivers, lakes, springs, glaciers, and other bodies of water that give life to your creatures. Especially, we pray for our local rivers and creeks, the Great Miami, the Mad, Stillwater, Twin, and Wolf. Form us into a baptized body that protects the waters on which we rely. Lord, in your mercy. Righteous God, instill in all the leaders of nations a desire for justice and the will to serve the oppressed. We pray especially for those nations in which dictatorship threatens the population. Guide our nation's governors in their difficult pathway between the threat of disease and the dangers of scarcity and isolation. Bring our legislators into agreement about how to assist those in need. Give us patience in facing our current predicament. Lord, in your mercy. Compassionate God, visit all who are in great need, those who suffer from the coronavirus, those living in loneliness and fear, those without jobs, and those who mourn their dead. Uphold those whose futures have been taken away from them. We pray for healthcare workers and for the residents in care homes, prisons, and refugee camps. For the countless persons who carry heavy burdens on their back, we pray and we call out to you these names: Judith, Helen, Wendy, Ron, Lisa Ann, Jane, Vicky, Marion, Joyce, Lynn, Paula, Candy, Debbie, DJ and Alexander, Anthony, Casey and Eric, Rachel and family, Jackson, Jerry, Karen, Joe, John, Terry, Simon, Brandon, Anita and David, Jenny, Roberta, and Pamela, and especially all who mourn Vicky, Nate, Ray, Mike, Chuck, Dick, and Don. Lord, in your mercy. Benevolent God, give the world a solution. Lord, in your mercy. Fatherly and motherly God, embrace all orphans. Support the agencies that attend to the world's orphans. Shield orphaned children from traffickers. Give to all nations wisdom concerning the refugees who are children. Watch over all children whose usual caregivers are absent. Form us into your children who love all which you have made. Lord, in your mercy. Eternal God, your kingdom is here, now, and it has no end. We remember the saints who have gone before us, especially those who have died of COVID-19, and those whom we remember in our hearts. Unite us forever in the resurrection of Jesus Christ. Lord, in your mercy. With bold confidence in your love, Almighty God, We place all for whom we pray into your eternal care. Through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Let us now together join in the prayer that Jesus taught his disciples. Let us pray together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. The peace of Christ be with you always. Let us share a sign of that peace with one another, present with us physically, or together virtually, or knit together through the Holy Spirit. Peace be with you.
Peace be with you.
Okay.
Peace be with you.
Peace be with you.
Peace be with you.
Peace be with you.
This is the day that God has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Our God continues to bless us. For many people, this is a time of uncertain financial situations and how we're going to pay the bills and how we're going to live. For many of us, our income is stable or we have savings. Listen, God has given us all that we need. God always is a God of abundance. And so let us share that need, that abundance we have with each other, doing the work that God has called us to do, the ministry and mission of our Lord. So, let us pray that God would give us generous hearts. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord's face shine on you with grace and mercy. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. Amen. Please join us now in singing the sending song. It's on page 8 in the worship folder. Love divine, all loves excelling.
Thank you.
Christ is risen. Alleluia. Go in peace, serve the Lord.